I am Mayra Rivera, professor of religion and Latino studies at Harvard Divinity School. And it is my great honor and pleasure to welcome you tonight to this fabulous event. Thank you all for coming. The lecture today is sponsored by the Harvard Divinity School in collaboration with the Committee on Ethnicity, Migration, and Rights of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences and the Instituto Cervantes. We are very grateful for their contributions. I want to thank the Harvard Art Museum, particularly Mary Schneider Enriquez, Jessica Martinez, and Dakota DeVos for their help and support. And let me just say that the exhibition will be open for an hour after the lecture. And my thanks to Andrea Davis. Her diligence, competence, and enthusiasm were indispensable for planning this event. Thank you, Andrea. And of course, my deep appreciation for our distinguished guest, Edwidge Danticat. Danticat is widely known for her unforgettable depictions of Haiti's history and their effects in the lives of Haitian immigrants. Her works of fiction include Breath, Eyes, and Memory, 1994, Krik, Krak, 1995, The Farming of Bones, 1998, The Dewbreaker, 2004, Claire of Sea Light, 2013, and Entwine, 2015. Her memoir, Brother, I'm Dying, published in 2007, tells the story of her uncle, Reverend Joseph Dantica, who fled violence in Haiti to seek asylum in the US, but was detained by Homeland Security and died in immigration custody. Required reading. Her collection of essays, Create Dangerously, the Immigrant Artist at Work, has been required reading for many of our courses at Harvard. Her book, The Art of Death, Writing the Final Story, will be released this year. Danticat has received numerous awards, including the American Book Award in 1999, the National Book Critics Circles Award 2007, the MacArthur Genius Fellowship 2009, the Toni Morrison Award 2016, among others. Danticat is also a trusted public intellectual. Her pieces in The New Yorker, The Atlantic, and Sojourners magazine, among others, help readers see the challenges of our current moment in new light and with renewed commitments. Beyond these remarkable accomplishments, I want to share with you why, when discussing the questions that raised by the exhibition of Doris Salcedo's work entitled The Materiality of Mourning, I immediately thought of Edwidge Danticat's haunting stories. Danticat writes about political violence within the island of Española and across the ocean, the violence of US invasions and its immigration policies. She writes of immigrant experiences, of how immigrants carry with them the scars of violence. Still, it was the distinctive way in which Danticat deals with the persistent effects of history in the intimate dimensions of individual lives that suggested a fruitful dialogue with Salcedo's work. Danticat's writing stays close to the materiality and the body, even as she explores far-reaching implications of historical events. In Breath, Eyes, and Memory, she writes, "I come from a place where breath, eyes, and memory are one, a place from which you carry your past like the hair on your head, where women return to their children as butterflies, or as tears in the eyes of the statues that their daughters pray to." In The Farming of Bones, she describes the testaments written on the bodies of women. "Misery won't touch you gentle. It always leaves its thumbprints on you. Sometimes it leaves them for others to see. Sometimes for nobody but you to know of," one of her characters says, as if to challenge the reader to learn how to sense those scars that are barely visible or not visible at all. When I think of Danticat's work, I remember the struggles of her characters, often struggles to death, but also the passions that make them, that make us so vulnerably human. The Farming of Bones is set in the time of the slaughter of Haitians instigated by the Dominican dictator Rafael Trujillo by blaming the closest others for their country's troubles. The Farming of Bones is a love story, however. I read the words of its protagonist. "For some, passion is the gift of a ring in a church ceremony, the bearing of children as shared property. For me, it was just a smile I couldn't help, tugging at the sides of my face. And slowly as he caught glimpses of me between sips of coffee, he returned the smile, looking the same way I did, bashful, undeserving, and almost ashamed to be the one responsible for the look of desire always rising the dark flush on the side of his face." This is a story of love between two young people, subject to the hard, unrecognized labor that is often the lot of immigrants, two young people who would face the horrors of violence. Danticat's attentiveness to the specificity of their shared smile reveals in its contrast the homogenizing rhetoric used by those who incite violence, as well as the carelessness of those who ignore or fail to protect those threatened by it. Focusing on the minute details of everyday lives, the beauty and the pain, Danticat invites us to see differently and ultimately to live differently. In the lives of ordinary people, we see the deepest consequences of genocide. Her careful exploration of the particular stories of Haitian communities in Hispaniola or the US, guide us to the deep truth about who we are as a nation, as humanity. The narratives are singular, and yet they challenge us to engage the world in its heart-wrenching loveliness. This is how a former priest who had witnessed the massacres in the farming of bones puts it. It took a love closer to the earth, closer to my own body to stop the tears. I have lost, but I have also gained an even greater understanding of things both godly and earthly. Welcome, Edwidge Danticat.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you all for coming in on such a beautiful afternoon. Thank you, Mara, for that just beautiful introduction. And Andrea Davis for all the logistics, Arvid Hart Museum, Mary Schneider, the curator, and the Divinity School for having me. I must acknowledge the presence of a goddess on campus today. That would be the goddess Rihanna, my dear Caribbean sister. I know it was really a tough call for some of you to choose between us. I wouldn't have been mad at you for skipping. Some of the kids are going, wait, Rihanna's here? What am I doing here? First things first, if you haven't seen the exhibition, Doris Salcedo, The Materiality of Mourning, I hope you will go see it. Nothing I see here will match the experience of actually experiencing it. It's a powerful and haunting exhibition, as is all of Doris's work. So this is how I thought I would proceed this afternoon with our other goddess, Doris Salcedo. I will do this in three hopefully seamless parts. First of all, I will tell you how I came to Doris Salcedo's work. Then I will highlight a few pieces from the work that have special resonance for me and some recent work that I've been doing, and look at some connections between her work and two Haitian artists at a very particular moment in Haitian life. Then I'll do a short reading of something of my own that jolted me into acknowledging the materiality of my own mourning and grief. I know this sounds like a lot. It won't take as long as it sounds, I promise. So here we go. How I believe Doris Salcedo's work drew me here. I was invited to give this lecture at the same time that I was in the middle of writing a book called The Art of Death, Writing the Final Story. The Art of Death is part of a series of craft books by Grey Wolf Press. The series, The Art of Series, offers a writer an opportunity to offer his, her, their insight on how a particular subject might be addressed in writing, or how it has been addressed in the past. The books are usually a blend of memoir, literary criticism, writing advice, and the subject is addressed in whatever way the writer likes or thinks is best. I approached Grey Wolf Press about writing for the series after my mother died in October 2014. I thought it would be a therapeutic way to face death as both a grieving person and from the perspective of both a reader and a writer. I thought it would be a rather therapeutic way to mourn. So my contribution to the series, this book, which will be published this July, is at once a personal account of my mother dying from ovarian cancer and an examination of the ways that other writers have approached death in their work, ranging from Gabriel Garcia Marquez's 100 Years of Solitude to Toni Morrison's 1973 novel, Sula. So I was in the middle of writing The Art of Death when I received an email from Mayra Rivera asking if I wanted to come to Harvard to talk about Doris Salcedo's work. This is really strange, I thought, because it just so happens that there is a Doris Salcedo exhibition at the Perez Museum in Miami, which is about 15 minutes from my house. So I went to the Perez to see the work, and because I was working on a book on death and mourning, and because I was still in the process of mourning my mother, I had to try really hard to keep myself from sobbing while in the museum. In addition to all of this, more than a decade before, in August 2000, I had visited Bogota, Colombia, where Doris, I hope she and I can be on a first name basis now, was born and still works. I was in Bogota for a literary conference whose theme was El amor y la palabra, love in the word. Bogota reminded me a lot of Port-au-Prince, where I was born. My husband was with me, he too is Haitian, and we kept saying how two things in Bogota made us feel completely and totally at home. The first was that the hills and mountains were visible from inside the city. The second was that all everyone kept talking about was the insecurity, la inseguridad, which was for us an echo of l'insécurité or problème insécurité, which everyone was also talking about then and is often talking about in Haiti. In fact, we had just left Haiti before going to Colombia, and we were questioned at the airport in Miami for making back-to-back trips to those two countries in the same month. This is all to say that I felt extremely at home in Bogota. There was even a statue of Alexandre Pétion, one of our first presidents, who had housed and funded Simon Bolivar's expedition to liberate Venezuela. The Pétion monument was at Quinta de Bolivar in Bogota, where Simon Bolivar spent some of his later years. So we felt right at home in Bogota, even though at that time the newspapers were filled with stories of muggings, break-ins, and kidnappings. Colombia had the longest running conflict in our hemisphere, and nearly a quarter of a million people had been killed or disappeared, and millions of others displaced. At the same time, Bogota was bustling with life. Public places were filled with people, and there were parties everywhere. The closing event at the literary conference was held in a park in the middle of the city. Thousands of people attended on a long night of readings by 52 authors. You guys are lucky, you just have me. After the reading, there were fireworks, and I thought to myself, this is why art lives and thrives, even in difficult times. And these folks, these Bogotanos and Bogotanas, sure know how to do it. I'd like to think now that Doris Salcedo was there that night watching the fireworks under the same skies with me, or that our mere presence in the park, 52 writers and thousands of readers and listeners, all of us listening and reading in different languages while geographically 2,600 meters closer to the stars. I'd like to think that we could have been a Doris Salcedo installation. At the end of the conference, we were asked to sign a photo that had been taken of us during our visit to Bogota, and we were asked to write something around it. Around my picture, my God, youth is great, isn't it? So young. Around my picture, I wrote, "Ou bat tambou et puis ou danser après." After you beat the drum, you dance. It was my version of a Haitian proverb that says, "Ou bat tambou et puis ou danser encore." You beat the drum and you dance again. The darker, less celebratory version of that, the grieving, mourning version of that proverb might be, "C'est après bataille ou compter blessé." You count the wounded after the fight. But I didn't want to write something somber, so I wrote this. After you beat the drum, then it's time to dance. Then added, so is life, and so is writing. If there are English teachers here, I probably should have written, so with life, so with writing. Writers always editing. I suppose one might also say, so it is with Doris's work. Doris beats the drums. She counts the wounded. Then her visions, images, sculptures, and installations dance. In some cases, like grass in the wind, or roses against concrete. But we limit the function of dance if we only think of it as an expression of one type of celebration. Dancing can also be an expression of grief. When in shock, we might rock our bodies back and forth as we cry. Some of us also dance in funeral processions, use mourning dances to help us say goodbye. Dance is an act of body memory, or rememory, as Toni Morrison might say, as is beating the drum, which is what I was thinking when I wrote these words around this photo while sitting in a cafe in Bogota. When I was asked to come up with a title for this talk, I was still working on the Art of Death book, and part of the research for writing the book was reading Toni Morrison's 1973 novel, Sula. Sula, for those of you who've not read it, is about two women, Nell Wright and Sula Pierce, and their friendship over, you know, it's a very contentious friendship over several decades, and it's also about the story of their families and their communities. After having seen Doris's show in Miami, one of the many things that popped to mind after a fresh rereading of the novel was the scene in Sula when one of the women, Nell, is in the woods remembering her long dead friend. This is a bit of that scene. Suddenly, Nell stopped. Her eyes twitched and burned a little. "Sula?" she whispered, gazing at the top of the trees. "Sula?" Leaves scurried, mud shifted. There was the small overripe green things. A soft ball of fur broke and scattered like dandelion spores in the breeze. And the loss pressed on her chest and came up with her throat. "We was girls together," she said, as though explaining something. "Oh Lord, Sula," she cried. "Girl, girl, girl, girl." It was a fine cry, long and loud. Loud and long, but it had no bottom and it had no stop, just circles and circles of sorrow. Just circles and circles of sorrow. "Girl, girl, girl," I wanted to say to Doris Salcedo at the museum in Miami, "this monumental work of yours is your circles and circles of sorrow. You are creating for us works and acts of collective mourning so profound that it has no bottom and no top, just circles and circles of sorrow." Doris Salcedo's predecessors in my life are Haitian artists, many of whom have also been creating around their circles of sorrow. A few weeks after the January 12, 2010 earthquake that killed over a quarter of a million people and displaced over 1.5 million in Haiti, I went back to the town of Léogane, which was one of the areas most affected by the earthquake. My family is from there. While walking to where my grandmother's house used to be, I saw next to pieces of cardboard with written pleas for help and food and the entryway of a makeshift camp a huge white tent with a striking image painted on it, a stunningly beautiful chocolate angel with her face turned up towards an indigo sky as she floats over a pile of buried corpses. I didn't take a picture of that image. I was kind of shell-shocked from seeing this place I had known all my life become unrecognizable. But later I would kind of see it again and a work which had a similar spirit, and an image that an artist friend, Pascal Monet, without knowing this other person at all, or having never seen that other image at all, drew spontaneously after the earthquake. This piece, untitled, ended up in the New York Times as an illustration for a piece on how Haitian artists were responding to the earthquake. It also became the cover image of my book of essays, Create Dangerously, where some of you might have seen it. Pascal wrote a poem to accompany this image. As I mentioned, the image is untitled, just as many of the Salcedo pieces are untitled, as though a title might be too reductive for the enormity of the stories and the lives that both have to tell. So Pascal wrote an accompanying poem which addressed the disorientation of being a survivor in an extremely traumatized city, while also being briefly addressing the long history of the country's devastation. Horror, haggard stare, people in a daze, a city suspended, destroyed, the dead, so many dead, and the living zombie-like survivors looking for friends and family, a city in chaos whose trapped children scream under rubble. The twins are born in the cathedral rubble. A nation gives itself over to God the Americans, the French, whoever will take us, who survive any way we can, a traumatized cities, survivors, my little Lena, 2 months old, gurgling when she wakes. And Lena is her daughter and part of her personal story. Doris Salcedo too cites poetry as inspiration for her work. She often cites Paul Celan, the Romanian poet who wrote in one of his most famous poems, Death Fugue, of Jewish prisoners in concentration camps drinking black milk, symbolic of poison and slow death. He also writes of being ordered to dig mass graves by Nazi guards. This is only an excerpt. Black milk of daybreak, we drink it at sundown, we drink it at noon in the morning, we drink it at night, we drink and we drink it, we dig a grave in the breezes, there one lies unconfined, a man lives in the house, he plays with the serpents, he commends a strike up for the dance. Around the time that Pascal Monet's drawing was published in the New York Times after the earthquake, this was the cover of the New Yorker magazine featuring Franz Zéphyrin, The Resurrection of the Dead. It was painted in 2007, 3 years before the 2010 earthquake, but it could have been painted soon after the earthquake as well. Those figures in the doorway are guédés, spirits or lois, who exist on the threshold between life and death. The disaster shown here can also be the recent devastation by Hurricane Matthew in the south of Haiti last October. These figures are there to remind us that the dead never quite leave us. Art is the death of death, Doris Salcedo has said. My work, she says, addresses a person who is no longer here. In places like Haiti and Colombia, where life can be even more precarious than in other places, places where power shifts quickly, where people can quickly be unlanded, and where physical structures, including bodies, can be shattered, destroyed, or disappeared in an instant, places which, as Salcedo says, have a pariah status, someone is always absent. Whether through death, disappearance, or migration, someone is always not there. Someone is always Lord Bordeaux, as we say in Creole, on the other side of the water. And that absence is felt as deeply as a presence. But through art, that absence can be brought to life. It can be made visible. I think my work should play a role that is similar to funeral oration, Salcedo has said, which is a role that these pieces by Pascal Monet and Franz Zéphyrin play as well. But these works of rememory and their work, in Pascal and in Franz's work, they choose to show us bodies. Or in Zéphyrin's case, he shows us spirits made flesh. But in Salcedo's work, and we'll look at a few pieces in a bit, there is only us. When we walk through her installations or stand before her sculptures, we stand fully in that absence. We stand in for the dead. The only possible response I can give in the face of irreparable absence, Salcedo has said, is to produce images capable of conveying incompleteness, lack, and emptiness. We, in interacting with her work, feel this lack of emptiness with our presence and our still alive bodies. So, consider the artist who must create among physical and emotional ruin. Consider all the dead they feel obliged to bring back to life. Those who have disappeared, those who have been erased, sometimes by nature, sometimes by political violence. Consider the gaps these artists must fill in the midst of social and political trauma. Consider the will, rather the stubbornness, it must take to not only create, but to keep defying death in order to do it. There can be, as Doris Salcedo has said, no neutral spaces in this kind of environment. As this installation, 1,550 chairs stacked between two city buildings at the 2003 Istanbul Biennial shows, there's also an urgent desire to combat incompleteness, to fill empty spaces, as though one were always standing on the edge of a gravesite and was constantly looking down at a void, demanding to be filled. There's always this urgent desire to give to the lightness of air and memory, the weight of tangibility and visibility, and the bulk, solidity, substantiality, the materiality of wood, concrete, or stone. One artist is trying to record a new reality, a city that was once cement and wire and wood, now a city of tents and lean-tos made with cardboard and sheets. Another artist is saying, there must be no voids left. But both are trying to respond and what is ultimately, are trying to respond to what is ultimately and irreparably absence. How are the disappeared made material? But this time through shoes. This piece is called Atrabilarios, or worn shoes, which might be the only traces left of a particular person who has disappeared. The encasement, the blurring, makes it look and feel like memory. Myra mentioned my 81-year-old uncle who died in immigration custody after leaving Haiti during a difficult time in 2004 and requesting asylum. His medication was taken away, he was detained, and then he died chained to a hospital bed because he requested asylum. And one of the ways that I remembered him was that I kept the shoes that they gave me, that the immigration people gave me, which was in his briefcase after he died. And every once in a while, I would slip my foot into them and strangely feel very much closer to him during those times. I still wear some of my mother's shoes. We had the same shoe size since I was a teenager. But I'm already mourning a time where there will be no shoes of hers left, when I would have worn them to shreds. Then I imagine they will be like these shoes, memory shoes, blurred by age and time, like million-year-old insects forever trapped in ember. This piece is called Plidaria Muda, or Silent Prayer. It began with Salcedo's research into gang violence in Los Angeles. In Colombia, she often interviewed children who had lost their parents to violence. For this piece, she interviewed parents, particularly mothers, who had lost their children to gang violence. Yes, the tables look like coffins, but life grows among them, just as grass somehow defiantly manages to grow in concrete. In writing the Art of Death book, one thing I have come to learn is that one cannot create art about death, which is also not in some way about life. A large part about creating death is about creating life. We cannot think of death without also thinking about life, and perhaps prayer, especially made tangible like this, visual, physical, is one bridge between life and death. Just as grass can grow over dead bodies, and in a kind of conspiracy with nature can participate in erasure, it can also lead us to renewal. I grew up in houses where we prayed constantly. I used to tell myself that everything done with intent was considered prayer, that art is a kind of prayer, that silence can be prayer, that even children are prayers, living and growing prayers, that love is the most powerful prayer of all, the prayer of grieving mothers for their children to grow up against all odds in isolated and hostile terrain where they're not only supposed to, they're not supposed to even live, much less thrive. That is the most powerful prayer of all. It's important to die in holy places, the main character of Michael Ondaatje's The English Patient says, though sometimes we must become our own holy places. And this, I think, of a kind of holy place, a Roman cathedral, a memory mausoleum. Every one of my pieces has begun with the testimony of a victim of political violence, whose experience is a requirement for the very existence of my work, Salcedo has said. Her public actions or interventions, another element of her work, certainly shows this. This installation or action, called November 6 and 7, show 280 wooden chairs lowered from the roof of the Palace of Justice in Bogota on the 17th anniversary of the 1985 siege of the Palace of Justice by M19 guerrillas, and the military response to that, which was very brutal and led to all those deaths. The dead, including the justices, were caught in the crossfire, and a chair was lowered for each of them. This Acción de Duelo, the candles, nearly 24,000 candles, were lit in the Plaza de Bolívar in Bogota after the death of deputies who had been kidnapped and held in captivity for 5 years. After journalist and political activist Jaime Garzón was assassinated in 1999, Salcedo intervened with public installations of flowers. Soon after she begins her actions, often people join in, showing us that mourning is also a contagious act. Gathering us through rituals can sometimes help us mourn together. One of her most recent actions is this shroud, sumando ausencias, which adding absences. And the shroud is in response to the halt and peace agreements in Colombia. And here you have 2,000 pieces of white cloth creating a massive shroud that covered the plaza with the names of victims of violence written in ashes. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. I think the space of an installation can become a beautiful form of political resistance, Salcedo has said. And to my mind, nothing shows this more than this piece, Shibboleth, the 2007-2008 installation at the Tate in London, where she literally, I don't know how she got them to do this, let her put a big crack on the floor. Shibboleth in the Bible, for example, shows the use of language against an enemy. There it might mean an ear of corn or river. However, it is an identification marker that makes language also a border. For example, might I mention the farming of bones, which is my novel about the massacre of Haitian cane workers in the Dominican Republic. And one way that they differentiated whether people were Haitian or not, where they were asked to say the word perejil, which in Creole is pesi. So perejil was their shibboleth. We take it for granted that the earth beneath our feet is solid until it is not. So this shibboleth also reminds me of earthquakes. And these days, borders feel a lot like earthquakes. And the community in Miami where I live, and I'm sure in many communities in the United States, I have to say that at the FedEx just down the street this afternoon, I saw a border patrol car and my heart started beating fast because I've never seen border control cars like in everyday life before. So, but this is our new reality. Our cracks on the floor. And I live in a community where people are very afraid because it seems like we're all one document away from being on the wrong side of these man-made cracks in the ground that we called borders. So this piece speaks very powerfully also to our current landscape and demands us to choose whether we're going to keep our head buried in the proverbial sand or rise to confront these borders. The other reason I chose the title of this talk is because I realized as I was mourning my mother that grief actually does come in circles. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross's grief cycle of denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and finally acceptance does not always happen in that order. No one told me that grief felt so much like fear, C.S. Lewis wrote in A Grief Observed. No one told me either. For in grief, nothing stays put, he wrote. One keeps emerging from a phase, but it always recurs round and round. Everything repeats. Am I going in circles, or dare I hope on a spiral? Doris Salcedo movingly and brilliantly takes us on her spirals and circles. And for that, I personally, I am very grateful. After my mother died, I experienced some spirals myself, but mostly in dreams. I'm going to close with one of those dreams, which also, as I said, for me, was a jolting reminder of the materiality of things and their ability to help us mourn. So a year to the day after my mother died, I dreamed that I woke up shaking after realizing that I had abandoned her in the hospice ward for an entire week and had completely forgotten about her. That was a dream. In the dream, I jump out of bed and rush to the hospital, panicked that my mother had been buried without anyone she loved saying goodbye. The hospice room in my dream looked a lot like the one my mother had actually stayed in, with plain white walls and a window overlooking a courtyard with a walking trail that snaked through a garden full of cement benches. In my dream, when I walk into that room, I find my mother standing by her bed waiting for me. She looks like she did in her coffin at her funeral, thin, though not as haggard, and somewhat youthful looking, thanks to the layers upon layers of very dark pancake makeup on her face. In my dream, she's wearing a long black wig and a short cocktail dress with silver sequins in the front. And before I can hug her, she begins rocking herself, then starts dancing a slow, mournful dance. As she is dancing, I realize that she doesn't recognize me. I suddenly don't recognize her either. I can't figure out who the woman I'm looking at is, but she's not my mother. So I quickly turn around and walk out of that room without saying goodbye. In the hallway outside the hospice room, I mumble a few words to myself about a purse. A few months before, among my mother's things, I had found a beautiful purse. My mother was very fond of purses. She also liked church hats, but had more purses than church hats. Maybe it was because she used to make purses in the factories where she worked as a young woman. In any case, she liked having purses around. Most of the handbags and purses I found in my mother's house in New York and eventually ended up giving away had pieces of hard caramel candy tucked in the pockets, along with bus fare, $2 worth of coins individually wrapped in paper napkins. Out of my mother's dozens of purses, I had only kept a few and had one on the night table by my bed. It was a seashell-shaped vintage purse covered with dark gray and silver beads. The two-headed metal claps clicked loudly when you opened and closed it. The inside was lined with gold-colored silk that had faded in some places and gotten browner in others. Inside a tiny pocket, I saw the number 2 written in black permanent marker, then realized that this purse had cost my mother $2 at the Goodwill near the diagnostic center where she'd had some of her early tests. The same Goodwill where she and I would browse through shelves and bins searching for such treasures. Somehow that purse makes its way into my dream, and as I walk away from the dancing woman in the hospice ward, the woman who was not really my mother, I begin talking to my mother about that purse. Mama, sase busu, I mutter under my breath. Mama, this is your purse. It is a purse inside a dream, as if there is nothing left for it to carry in the real world. But I am still carrying it, like I am still carrying you. Mama, I miss you. Mama, I love you. Mama, repose. Please rest. Thank you.
Can you talk about how mourning has changed your language and the way you write? How are the circles there in terms of your engagement with the writing now?
Well, one of the the question is about how has mourning changed my work in this how the circles have been. I mean, one of the reasons I took on this project of the art of death is that I felt like I could read. I mean, there are a lot of people when they're mourning who they say they can't read, but I felt like I could read, but I wasn't sure I could write. And this felt like something that would compel me back into writing. So I think there's sort of a deeper engagement, certainly with mortality. One of the things that I realized, like when you watch somebody die, like when they die in your arms, like my mother did me, is that it's as if death walked in the room and just picked one of you, right? And so you were suddenly so aware that it's like, oh, my turn will come one day. And I was, you know, I was telling someone, I said, I kind of missed that when I just didn't, like, it wasn't a thing I thought about when, you know, it just never occurred to me. I missed that. And so I think it's a deeper realization. I have a friend, for example, who was saying, you know, she said, a writer friend who said, you know, there's so many, I have a story that I can only write when my parents are gone, she says. And so, you know, there are things that even in this book about mourning that I've written that I wouldn't have written if my parents were alive. So I think there, you know, it sort of deepens your own humanity, your own relationship with mortality and with the present and the past, which inevitably goes into the writing, and I think that's also the power of this work too, because it's a constant engagement with that. You know, it refuses to allow us to forget not just about our own vulnerability and fragility, but also of the entire society. In a society like Colombia or Haiti, that people don't really have the luxury of forgetting that.
So I'm gathering from your talk that you and Salcedo have not met personally. Mm-hmm. So my question would be, if you had a chance to sit down with her over a glass of wine or a cup of coffee, what would you ask her and what would you share about yourself?
I think, you know, I feel like we've had coffee because I've watched all the videos, including the interview she did here. And I'm like one of these people that I'm the opposite with people I admire. I kind of prefer it. I'm always worried. Like, I also, knowing what work like this demands of somebody's soul, I was like, you've given me enough. Like, you don't have to be my friend on top of it, you know? That's how I am with people, people whose work I love. I was like, you know, the time you could be having coffee with me, you could make something. So I do not demand that engagement of the artists I love. But if we're in the same place, yeah, I'm sure we would tell each other some secrets. You know, I love her hair. That's the first thing I would say. I was like, I love your hair.
Thank you for your talk. My question concerns about the courage to mourn, especially in like public spaces. I feel like there's a lot of pressure to privatize your mourning process and not wear anything distinctive, you know, no more sackcloths or, and I feel that pressure myself, right? Like you're not supposed to cry in public. Can you address that? Like, especially in our current context about the courage to mourn and not be afraid to do that, especially in maybe some public places?
It's an incredible question. You're right, because also I think it's a little bit cultural too, right? So for example, after my mom passed away, I was shocked that people would be like, I know your mom just passed away, but can you, like, sorry about your mom, but, and I was really surprised by that. And I think because mourning has gone so into such a private place that people don't even expect you to grieve. Like it, that was my experience, right? That, and it's been, you know, so for example, my mother-in-law, who's 81, her brother just passed away, who's younger than her, had a heart attack. And she, to watch her mourn, like, you know, like she openly mourns. Like she'll say, I keep seeing him. She'll just, so, and I don't think we're in this culture so much where, you know, it's so sanitized, it's so away. You know, when my aunt who raised me in Haiti were, passed away, when we went to Haiti, we dressed her in the funeral home, we were given that option. But I just feel like it's so, it is removed. And because of that, people expect you to like really bounce back. So I think if you're mourning, you have to ask that, you know, you have to just take that time for yourself. But you're definitely right that it's not something that the culture expects you to take time, you know, unless it's folded into some kind of religious practice, then people are obligated to respect it. But just like circular mourning, it's almost non-existent, you know.
Hi, thank you for Hello. Coming. It is such an honor to finally hear you. I've been reading your book since I was a young girl. And it's only thank now, you. Perhaps because I'm older and you're here in front of me, that I'm noticing these themes of griefs in your novels. I'm wondering if you can speak to the evolution of grief as you depict it and how that has changed for you. I know that often with authors, the first book that they produce is different from the last book, but you continuously have this theme of grief. Has it evolved for you? And why have you chosen grief to be a sort of connecting thread?
I don't, I guess I'm just a sad soul. It's, you know, my going back to this question of ritual, so my mother, when her mother died, wore black for 9 months and then gradually, you know, got in lighter colors. And she used to always say, she's like, you won't have to buy anything when I'm dead because you're already wearing black all this, which she thought was sort of like constantly symbolic of my eternal melancholy. I mean, but I feel like in terms of progression, so now I'm writing, for example, I'm writing a story now and I'm thinking, I was like, wow, if I were 24, I probably would have killed these people off already. Like, they probably would be dead. Like, and I think, but I think the more experience you have in real time with death, the more nuanced and complicated it becomes. So I think in terms of grief, that's probably, you know, I have a, sort of a not as much like a heavy hand with it. Like I really am interested in, I'm interested in all kinds of grief, like sort of leaving your country, leaving your family, and sort of how we recreate ourselves after we mourn and after we grieve. And I think probably that's why this work was so attracted me so much, because it does really, I mean, we try to do it in writing, you try to do it with words, you try to do it with images, but in this work, you're giving something that then you can project whatever you want on it, right? It can become for you. And as I said, you know, like when you're working through it, you're sort of like you're standing in for, you can stand up for one person that you're thinking about in that space when you're there, but you can also think stand for thousands. And so this, there's something I think really broad and universal about that, that's also very particular. But I was told that I was a sad person since I was born. It's like I could be like a character in a Marquez novel or something.
Thank you for your wonderful talk.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask about the contagiousness of mourning and the ways in which mourning can spread, in particular because you've said that mourning is sort of suppressed in our contemporary society. And so, but at the same time, it has this contagiousness. So what are the mechanisms of contagion when you think of mourning?
Well, I think certainly Salcedo's actions show it, right? So one example is that after the journalist was killed, she said, I'm going to put flowers along the road where he walked. And then people, I think curious, you know, they see, oh, there are these flowers, and people started bringing their flowers. A more closer to our time, when, like Princess Diana, right? We have these examples, I think, when people can find sort of a common focus of grief, they grieve. Like when a celebrity dies, or I mean, it's another kind of mourning, but then, you know, it's kind of like the country mourns. Or so I think that kind of contagion, it's either organic or it's, you know, or it could be created. But people, when something happens that we all feel in common, there's a individuals, then you feel helpless, and then you're kind of comforted by the fact that other people are mourning too. I think that's the contagion, and the work sort of is forcing that, because what she's reacting against is what she sees as indifference, right? She's like, I'm gonna put these roses there to remind you that someone died and that they keep dying, and then people are like, okay, for their own reasons, they join in. So I think this work is sort of demanding that, is demanding attention, it's demanding that contagion, it's like a force, it's like pushing against indifference. So that's the contagion. What's harder is like that personal kind of mourning, because it's like pain. It's like when somebody says, you know, even when you're in the hospital and they're like, is it 1 or 10? Like, you know, we don't feel other people's pain, which is what in that first conversation where they were talking about the pain of others, you know, the Sontag, you know, the pain of others. It's very hard to know the pain of others. And I think, you know, in writing and in this, you know, at least it's trying to approximate the pain of others, and it's forcing us to care. Thank you very much.